Hello, how are you guys doing today? Awesome. So my name is Srivatsan. I'm a dev in the Windows Azure BizTalk Services team. So today's session, this session is going to be about Windows Azure BizTalk Services. So this is our platform service offering on Azure. And as Scott announced, we are live today. And all the stuff that we are going to show today, you'd be able to try it out later in the day. All right? So following this agenda, so quickly we are going to take an overview of the integration service lifecycle, the various personas that are involved, that interact with the service on a day-to-day basis. And then we are going to talk about the experiences of these various personas, the capabilities, and the experiences that we enabled on Windows Azure BizTalk Services. And then quickly we'll wrap it up with some key takeaways. So if you look at the personas on a very high level, we talk about IT admins or IT ops who deal with creating and managing of the service. This is basically the BizTalk environment that the IT administrators kind of create and manage. And there is this developers who help in developing the applications, the message flows, and kind of wire things up and kind of hand it over to the IT admins to go deploy in the production environment. Right, and we have this business analyst or business administrator who have good context about BizTalk. They understand the concepts, who help in creating trading partner agreements, who understands how the business flows work. And these are the guys who closely work with the developers in creating a business application, BizTalk application, and work with the, and eventually work with IT administrators to go deploy it on the production environment. Right? If you contrast it, IT administrator's life in a BizTalk server environment, it used to be like these people will go procure machines, set up the network, install the operating systems, install SQL Server, install a BizTalk server, go configure it, and it would take weeks, if not months, before they go deploy the application on this environment. I'm going to show you how it is going to be easily done on the services world. It's going to take exactly three steps in kind of provisioning a service on the Windows Azure BizTalk Services. Can you switch over? So what I've done is basically I've logged in into Azure. So with this, we are showing you BizTalk Services here. I'm going to quickly go and create a BizTalk service. I need to provide a name for the BizTalk service environment. So I'm going to call it as So as Vivek was pointing out, we support four editions today, basic, developer, premium, and standard. So for this demo, I'm going to select a developer. So we support various regions where you can go deploy these services. So let me pick one of the regions. Right. In the SAMS demo, you would have seen how the messages are getting tracked. So for this, we need what is called a tracking database where all the message tracking information gets collected. So I'm going to kind of go create one tracking database. Or I could end up choosing the one that I've already created. In, for this example, I'm going to create a new tracking database. So I've already selected the SQL server on which I want to go create it. Let me give the password. For monitoring and archiving data, we need a storage account. So for all the service level monitoring diagnostics data needs to get collected in a storage account, so for which we need a storage. Already in use. And that's it. So it exactly takes three steps to provision a new BizTalk service environment. And in under 30 minutes, you would have a BizTalk service ready for you to go deploy an application. It's that easy. So before the session ends, you'll have this BizTalk service environment ready. So let's go look at specifically the IT admin experience here. We have just seen how easy it is to create a BizTalk service. We'll look at a bunch of other capabilities that we provide or the IT administrator would expect with Azure BizTalk services, right? He deals with creating and managing of the BizTalk service, and in case if he needs to go update the environment, update the settings, update the application, he needs those capabilities, as well as he would need if capability to take a backup of this entire service and restore it to deal with disaster recovery and so on and so forth, right? One of the things that we did, which is very different from most of the multi-tenant services that are available, is to kind of provide a dedicated environment. So we heard from our customers saying that they need an isolated environment given that it's an enterprise application that they would deploy. What we have done is we have sort of on Azure. We went with a dedicated model where we create dedicated resources for the customer service. What I mean by dedicated is the compute is completely dedicated. The storage that is created for your environment is completely dedicated and it's not shared with another customer's environment. Right? What this provides is predictable performance because it's just your application that is running in this environment. And from isolation point of view, your configurations, your application assets like maps, schemas, they are not getting shared with any other customer's environment. Right? And we completely take care of providing a managed service. Managed here is Microsoft will take care of provisioning those VMs, setting up the network, installing BizTalk service, and giving you an environment that is managed by Microsoft to care. And all you have to worry, you have to focus, is in your business logic and your business application. And if there are any issues with your business logic, you have to just worry about that aspect. We have built in an alerting mechanism. So if there are any issues with the service environment, we get alerted and Microsoft will rectify them for you, right? With that, we provide you a 99.9% availability service level agreement. So with this, you don't need to worry about the environment where you are actually running your business application. Right? You just saw how quickly we created a BizTalk service. I'm gonna quickly walk you over through, show this experience of what happens behind the scenes, right? So when you come to Azure portal, in three easy steps, you'd be able to kind of go create a service environment, right? This service environment is completely dedicated for your BizTalk service. And we also created under the hoods SSL certificate, a self-signed SSL certificate that you can go easily update it at a later point, right? I'll actually show you how you can go download the certificate. This is for secure connection. And we also give you a URI endpoint where you can go manage the service as well as if you want to kind of post the message to the message endpoint, right? So now you are ready to go use Visual Studio to go deploy the application. All you have to know is basically the ACS credentials through which you can authenticate against the management endpoint and go deploy your application on the BizTalk service that you have created. Now, once you have deployed, the service is ready and you'd be able to send a message to this endpoint. All you have to do is to authenticate for that message. You go to access control service, get an access token, put it in a message header, and you'll be able to post a message to the message endpoint. And it's that simple, right? With that, the message goes through your application flow and gets routed appropriately to the destination, gets processed in between. So it all completely depends on what your application does. While this is happening, we collect the tracking information about the message and that is getting collected into the tracking database that you have provided. As Sam showed, customers can build a tracking UI portal that you want to go look for all the messages, as well as Microsoft Management Portal has a good view of all the messages in the tracking view. That later Karthik is gonna show you how you can go look at these, right? We also collect service level diagnostics information in the monitoring store that you have configured. And if there are any issues with the service or with your application, the trace logs gets collected into this storage, right? Once the service is ready, you can go to management portal. I'm gonna quickly show you how you can go to the management portal and look at the management aspects. Can you switch over? See, the one that I've just created is in creating state. In under 30 minutes, it will be created. But for this demo, I'm going to show you the one that we already created. So there is a monitoring tab, which kind of shows all the performance counters that we are collecting under the hood. So you could look at a bunch of performance counters like CPU usage and the message processing related performance counters, so on and so forth. And you can kind of deduce like if there are any issues with your message processing and kind of go fix that application or messages wherever the issues are, right? We can quickly go over and see what are the other elements that are available for you to go take a look at it. So this is basically your quick start page. Here we have links to, from where you can download the SDK, you can how to get started with creating partner agreements, as well as if you want to go learn about BizTalk services more, there's a link to go land you into the MSDN link, right? So dashboard is where majority of the quick glance of the service is available. Again, we have the TOPS performance counters, as well as you can download the SSL certificate that we have provisioned for you, or you could end up uploading your own domain-based SSL certificate, which would help you to secure the connection with our management endpoint. The status of the service is active. This is the service URL through where you can go hit the service. The public VIP address. And the access control namespace that we have provisioned for you. We have configured the access control namespace. So you can directly go click on connection information, which will load the access control information. And from here, you'll be able to kind of use this information in your Visual Studio to go deploy the application onto the service. So we also have intelligent links to your tracking database and the monitoring store. If you click here, it will land you into your tracking database, and you can see if you are running into any capacity issues that you can go scale these tracking databases. That brings us into another interesting topic, scale. In the context of BizTalk server, in on-premise environment, you need to procure more machines if you want to end up scaling. Here is just one click, and we will take care of scaling and kind of provisioning extra VMs for you, right? So for developer, we don't support scaling, but in case if you have provisioned, say, a premium edition of the service, you'll be able to scale up to 8 BizTalk units. So we just looked at how easy it is to go create a BizTalk service and how easy it is to go manage a BizTalk service from IT admin perspective. So if you guys are available for tomorrow's deep dive session on EAI, we'll go look at some of the way, some of these and see how we can do the similar stuff using PowerShell. But now we're going to switch context. I'm going to invite one of my colleagues, Samir, who's going to talk about developer experience and some of the concepts associated with the developer experience.
Thank you, Sri. Just one second. So my name is Samir. I'm a senior program manager on the BizTalk team. And we just saw how easy it is to create your BizTalk service environment. Now, what I'm going to talk about is the developer experience in BizTalk service. And BizTalk service provides a very easy drag and drop experience through which you can quickly develop your integration application, right? So if you look at an integration application, it's essentially all about routing messages from a set of sources to a set of destinations, right? And when you route messages from a set of sources to destination, what we have seen is that there are common integration patterns that people typically use. We have seen that. So what we provide out of the box is an entity called a bridge. So you'll find that a bridge is a core basic block of your integration application. It has three components, so a set of sources, a set of destination, and a pipeline in between. So a sources are which defines where the messages come from. So in BizTalk service, we have every bridge has an implicit HTTP source endpoint. which means you can send messages through HTTP. We also have support for common protocols like FTP and SFTP. So in addition to HTTP, you could add a few other source endpoint, FTP or SFTP endpoint, and a bridge would be able to pick up messages from those HTTP server or SFTP servers. On the destination side, we have support for a whole lot of common systems like service bus, queues, topics, relays. We have HTTP, FTP, SFTP, any web service. Or in addition, it could also be another bridge endpoint so that you could chain your bridges and to increase your processing capability. In between the sources and the destination, what we have is a pipeline. So pipelines are interesting because what we provide is a pattern-based integration. So a pipeline allows you to do things like validation of the incoming messages, transformation, enrichment, and by enrichment, I mean, you can when you have a message coming in, you can identify interesting properties on the message, you can define those properties, or you can augment data from an external source and to say that, okay, this particular order which is coming is from a gold partner, so I want to process it differently so that you could use it when you are routing it to one of the destinations. When you route it to a destination, we use routing rules. So we support rule-based routing, and when you route it, you can also associate routing actions. So routing actions, for instance, when you're routing to, say, a service bus queue or a block, you could specify certain metadata properties along with it. Or you could say when you're routing it to an external web service, you can select and choose what is the SOAP action you want to stamp on the outgoing messages. So with this one, we'll just look at a quick demo of how this can be done. So on the screen, what we have is Visual Studio. As Srivastan was showing just right now, all you need to do is you need to install the SDK. Once you install the SDK, you will be able to create BizTalk service project. So let's just, so I already have a solution. Let me just add a new project here. And here you can see BizTalk service. So I can add a new BizTalk service project. When you do that, you see a visual designer surface on which you can simply drag and drop the entities that you want to do. Say, for instance, let's say we want to process some orders coming in from an FTP server, which you want to route it, say, maybe to a BLOF or a queue store, right? So you have support for sources here, so you can drag and drop, say, an FTP source. And we have support for different kinds of bridges. So BizTalk service have support for XML bridge, one-way bridge, XML request reply bridge, and pass-through bridges. In addition, we also have support for EDIX-12 bridges, which my friend Karthik will show you. So for our demo, let's just use an XML one-way bridge here. And the message that is coming from FTP to the one-way bridge, if you just connect to it and say, I'm going to pick up the message from this FTP server. So you click on the FTP server and you can specify properties. So the properties would be, what is the server address? What is the FTP server address from where you want to pick it up, right? So you could specify, right? You can specify a folder path from where you want to pick up the messages from. So I have some folder path here. You can specify. You can also specify things like the content type, whether you are picking up a flat file, a text, or an XML, right? Or you could say, hey, whether you are using SSL or not, whether you want to use if you want to use a particular file mask, you can specify all those things. Saying you want to pick up only files starting with star.xml and all the stuff. So these are the properties that the FTP adapter provides. So you can go and select, and specify some of these properties, right? So once you get the message from the FTP, now let's say you want to route it to a particular destination. So you can pick any of the destinations that you want. So let's say we just pick and drop a queue. which means I want to route it to a service bus queue. So again, you just connect to your bridge to that queue. You specify certain properties of the queue, including what is the runtime address of the queue. So I have a queue, so you can, let me see. Right? So we have a runtime address of the queue. So you can just specify that runtime address. And you can specify what is the authentication that you want to use when you are sending it to the queue. So we have support for shared service, shared secret, or shared access signature. Both are authentication mechanisms provided by service bus queues. So you can specify those secrets. Okay. And I said when you're routing it to a queue, you can define a filter condition based on which you want to route it. So these are the routing rules that I just talked about. So when you click on this, you can specify filter expressions. If the incoming message matches those filters, that the expression that you have specified, then the message would be routed to this particular destination. So in our example, you can say match all. So which means I want to send all the messages to this queue, right? Additionally, you can also define what we call as routing actions, which is when you're sending it to your destinations, these are some of the things that I want to do. So for instance, when you're sending it to a queue, you could say, I want to write identifier, set one of the identifier, maybe, the level or something like that, from a property that you define. So I'll just come to how you define properties in a short while, or you could use an expression here. So I can just say, in the broker message level, specify the use this expressions, right? So you can do that, and you can define this routing actions. In the pipeline, what we again have a configuration driven experience. So what you see on the screen is a list of stages in a pipeline, right? So you can see that first it goes through a decode stage, which means all the incoming messages will be decoded into a format. So for instance, if you have some flat file messages coming in, right, because many of the transactions today you have seen are in flat files. So it could be comma separated, it could be delimited. So you could have defined your own flat file schemas, and at this stage it will convert that incoming flat file into an XML message. In the validate stage is where the incoming messages will be validated against certain schemas that you specify, right? The enrich is where you identify interesting properties in the incoming messages so that you can use it in the later stages, maybe in the transformation or at the routing stages. Transformation is when you want to change the format from one data format to another format. So these are basic patterns that we provide. By providing this pattern, you don't have to assemble anything, you don't have to write anything, you just have to configure and use it, basically. So let's quickly see how some of these things can be done, right? So let's say you want to validate against an incoming schema. All you need to do is you click here and you can select one of the schemas. So first I have to do is I have to go to the project and add a schema. You can either add a schema or you can create a new schema if you want. But if you have a incoming, if you already have a schema, then, so I have a few schemas that I have defined here. So what I can do is I can quickly add an incoming schema, and I can say, this is a purchase order schemas that I've added is one of the incoming schemas that I want to validate against, right? So here, all you need to do is you have to enable the stage to true, and that's all, basically. In the enrich stage, what you do is you can define properties, as I just mentioned, right? So you define properties. The sources of the when you define your properties, you can get the sources of the property from multiple places. It could be coming from one of the headers as part of the incoming message. It could be part of the message body itself, or we could have an external data lookup, in which case you might want to say, so let's take an example, right? So let's say you have an incoming order coming in, okay? In the order, you may have a particular product ID, okay? So in that, based on that product ID, you may want to do a lookup to say, okay, how much discount I want to give on that particular product, right? So it could be a combination of product ID, the customer ID, and so on, or maybe the size of the product. So some of those things you can define using properties here. So you could use an expat. Expat is used to look up into a message folder. So here, in our case, you could say it could be the FTP file name, server name, those kind of stuff. So let's say we define a property called right? So you define a property. And the next step is where you do a transformation. So here, you just have to create a map that you want to transform against. So when you have messages coming from a source to a destination, it can happen, and it typically happens that the source and the destination, they have different message data format, right? So what you can do is you can create a map. So for that, what we'll do is we'll just add a few schemas which will allow us to create the transformation. So I can say add a new item, and I can define a map here, and I can say select the schema that I want. Say I want to do a transformation from PO purchase order 1 to purchase order 2, right? So when you do this, you can see that on the left side is my source schemas, which defines the format of the incoming message. On the right side is my destination schemas, and they are typically not the same. So what we provide is, we provide on the toolbox a rich set of operations that you can do. Typically, when you do the transformation, you can just drag, you can just draw a line and say, this is how I map the data, right? So it's all visually very intuitive. But we also provide a rich set of operations, like string operations. You can do string concatenations. You can have all sort of operations that you want on strings. We also have a rich set of looping operations. So typically, the data that you see has a lot of looping constructs, like arrays. Like if you have an order coming in, there will be multiple line items, right? So the looping operations will help you define the transformations easily for those kind of constructs. We also have arithmetic operations, logical operations, if then else, conditionals. We have list operations where you can temporarily create a list so that it also helps doing the transformation for complex scenarios. We have a few examples in our samples where we have clearly defined some very nice transformation that can be done using these constructs. We have cumulative operations. Say you want to have an aggregate, the maximum, the minimum, those kind of stuff. We have dead time, and we have a set of miscellaneous operations. So if you have, for instance, if you have defined a property in the enrich state, you could use the property here. So once you have defined your transformations, you just save the transformations. So once you have defined your transformation, you have the enrich state. All you need to now do is to deploy this application, right? So this is how you can quickly stitch together your integration application, and you can start deploying it. In order to deploy it, you need to provide a BizTalk service environment. Like Srivastan just showed you how to create one. So you specify that BizTalk service environments. So in our case, we also just created one, so let's just use this. And then you build and you can deploy. Now obviously, for the purpose of the demo, I didn't configure everything. So what I can show you is we already have you know, the same thing that I created here. This has the correct set of configurations. So you can see that I have set the FTP properties correctly. I have also set the queue properties correctly, and the transformation that you do, I have like incoming schemas. Okay, I have, you know, a simple transformation that I created basically, right? So once you have this, you can build your applications to see if there is any error. Right? And after that, once you find that there is no error, you can quickly deploy those application. So when you want to deploy your application, it asks for the ACS namespace and the secret. We just showed you how you can get that through the BizTalk portal. So let me type this. I remember this. So with this one, you can see that behind the scene, what we are doing is, it is deploying those applications one by one, right? All the artifacts that you have, the schemas, the transform, they are all deploying one by one. You also deploy the bridge, and you also start your FTP server. So now, the application has been deployed. Now, if I drop a message on my FTP server, it will pick up that message, it will do the basic transformation, and it will route it to this queue, right? So I can just show you how that's done quickly. So I have this input message, and so I'll convert it to an XML so that my FTP server will now pick up this data. And you should be able to see that in my queue if I go to the Server Explorer for this queue. Can see that you know, we are receiving that message, right? So this is how you know, very quickly you can build your integration applications. You don't have to write code or anything. It's all UI driven, configuration driven, very fast. Let me just switch back to the slide, please. So what we provide is we provide Visual Designer, a configuration-driven, pattern-based integration that allows you to do you know, that allows you to rapidly develop your integration applications. It's also very powerful and extensible. We can have support for custom code. So in case the common integration pattern doesn't suffice for you, we allow you to plug in your own custom code, and tomorrow we have a deep dive session where we can show some of those things in detail. So now we have seen how you can, we can stitch together in the integration application, but what happens in the case of a hybrid? Typically, you have data sitting on the premise, right? Locked in systems like your ERP systems or your SQL database, your Oracle database, and all of them are probably behind a firewall. So how do you unlock the data over there? So for that, what we provide is we provide what we call as BizTalk Adapter Service. With BizTalk Adapter Service, you can securely open a connection to the cloud, right? Using what we call as LOB release. You open a connection to the cloud, and you can also define what we call as LOB targets that can selectively unlock which on-premise systems and what specific operations on those on-premise systems you want to expose. So in all of these, you can do it through a management interface that we provide. And using that interface, we also provide tooling experience for developers as well as for IT admin personas, right? So for developers, we have a Server Explorer plugin within Visual Studio which can interact with BizTalk Adapter Service and create those LOB targets and relays. For IT admins, we have a partial scripts where you can manage those kind of things. So let's have a quick demo and see how that can be done. So in my Server Explorer, I have BizTalk Adapter Service, right? So in, when you have BizTalk Adapter Service, this is my BizTalk Adapter Service is running on my machine. So you just connect to it. You can see that there are different LOB types. Like we have support for Oracle, SAP, SQL, SQL Server Database. So these are the most common enterprise applications that you find today. We have support for all of that. And let's say you want to expose a SQL server operation to the cloud, yeah, for your application. For instance, in this particular scenario, what if I want to send the incoming order back to a SQL order database, which is sitting on the premise? How do I do that, right? So you click on SQL, you say add a SQL target. And what we provide is a wizard-driven experience, which takes you a step-by-step how that can be done. So in the case of SQL, you specify what is the SQL server you want to connect to. So let's say, in my case, it's just running in a SQL Express. I specify the name of the database, and I can just connect to it. When I connect to it, it shows me what are the different artifacts which are available in that LOB system. Now, this is very useful for complex systems like SAP, where you don't know which RFC or which particular MAPI or IDOC that you want to do, you want to expose, right? So you can search, you can browse, you can do those kind of stuff. So you can select the artifact that you want. So in our case, let's say, the orders table. So you can select just the order table to say that I will support all the operations in the order table, like inserting, deleting, select, and update, or you could selectively choose one of the operations, right? So once you select this, you now specify how authentication will happen at runtime. What I'm just showed you is how you do authentication from my machine, right? So typically your developers and the runtime messages, they will have different authentication mechanism. So we support different types of authentication mechanism. So it could be a fixed username and the password that you supply, or it could be an integrated Windows authentication, or the authentication could be flowing along with the message in some custom headers that we support, or it could be, you know, if you're using SOAP, then it could be the SOAP message credentials, right? So we support different authentication mechanism. So you once you just specify, let's say, once you specify the authentication mechanism, you select where exactly do you want to expose on the cloud. So this is where you specify an LOB relay URL. So we use service bus relay, and you can, if you have existing relays, you can just select one of the relays, or if you want, you can create your own relays, basically, which means in one service bus relay, we could have multiple targets, you know, clubbed into it, right? So let's just say I want to use my existing relay. You just specify a subpart for it. So I can say this is the, let's say, demo orders, right? And you are done. So the last stage is where we give the summary of what we are going to do. It says you will define a target connection URL, right? These are the set of operations that you are exposing. This is the security model that you are using. This is the endpoint or relay which you are using to expose your operations on the cloud, and you can just say create, and this will just create, right? So now you have your LOB operations exposed to the cloud. So now how do I use it in my app? It's very simple. What you do is you just drag and drop and put it here. And then once you do that, you can just connect your app and say, now the message will be routed to this SQL database. So again, you can specify if there is any specific filter condition that you want to use, right? So I can even delete this one now, right? So I can say, now start routing it to my on-premise SQL database. But there is one thing that I missed. What is that? The SQL Server database can have, as I said, right, when you're routing from a source to a destination, the message format could be different. So the SQL Server database will have a format which is very different from, you know, the format that I was using, right? So what you can do is you can import the schemas that you want, the schemas that it, that we are supporting. So again, all you need to do is you can say, add the schemas to this project, right? So when you do that, it imports a bunch of schemas. So now I have the schemas in my project, the schemas that allows me to define, okay, what is the message format that I should be using to push messages to my SQL database on the premise. So in the case of SAP, for instance, it's going to show up, you know, the IDOCs, you know, the format of the IDOCs. So once you have the schemas, all you need now, what you can do is you can go back and define a transform to that new schemas, and you can just deploy it. And this is how it works. So, can you switch back? So as you can see, what BizTalk service provide is configuration-driven, visual experience for the developers, including hybrid scenarios, kind of exposing your LOB systems, your on-premise data to the hybrid is extremely easy with this. And with this, I want to summarize what we have just said. There are certain concepts that we looked at. We looked at the concept of what a bridge is and the different types of bridge that BizTalk service provides. We have seen there are certain artifacts that you typically use to create your integration application. So the next thing is we'll look at the business admin experience, and for that, I'll invite Karthik on the stage.
Hey, thanks, Samir. Hello, everyone. My name is Karthik Bharti. I'm the senior PM in the BizTalk team focusing on B2B. In the next 15 to 30 minutes, we will look at some of the features, capabilities that we have introduced more from a business admin persona. You heard about Srivatsan talk about the IT admin persona. Then Samir talked about the developer experience, and we'll complete the picture by looking at the business admin experience. Okay, if you look at the business admin experience, it contains multiple experience that the admin undergoes, right? Like one among them is the trading partner management, and that's the focus of this session. What we will do is first we'll set the context on what are all the different verticals that the business admin manages, right? And these are nothing new to you. You have like anything ranging from healthcare to retail to transport, logistics, different verticals. The interesting aspect is each of these verticals have their own protocols. They dictate their own standards. There's a version for the standards, how a messaging happens, how an acknowledgement happens. Each of this is exchanged between two trading partners. Before we go deeper into the session, I want a quick show of hands on how many people in here use B2B in their day-to-day business. Okay, that's almost all of you. That's great to know. So now the question really becomes like, what are the new enhancements and concepts that we introduce in BizTalk services that can simplify the admin experience, right? So let's go back to the concepts first and kind of revisit this slide. And many of you, since all of you have used, are using B2B, the concepts are fairly familiar to you, right? In BizTalk, we have the notion of a partner representing a company, and the company is trading with another company. So there's obviously an interaction between two partners. And once you have a partner, each company has a set of businesses that run within the company. Like there might be one for IT, there might be one for procurement, there might be one for HR. So each of these businesses function with a relationship with another company. So what we have is the notion of a profile. A profile is part of a partner, right? And one or two profiles of two partners come together forming a trading partner relationship, and the set of technical settings they agree on is defined as an agreement. Now, this is distinctly different from the business agreement, which is more of a precursor to the technical agreement. You probably sign a legal contract between the partners saying on what you agree upon, and this translates into the set of technical agreement settings that's supported in BizTalk today. Okay, so now let's look at the capabilities that we have, right? So now, in case of the benefits that BizTalk offers, BizTalk has capabilities around trading partner management, OEM. There are a bunch of protocols we support. In case of server, we have healthcare, we have HL7 for healthcare, Swift for financials, we have RosettaNet for oil and gas, chemical, and so on and so forth, right? And obviously, there is X12 and Edifact for the retail and the logistics industry. Now, along with that, BizTalk also offers capabilities around batching, right? Just to look at what batching is, think of a scenario where you're sending a message to Walmart, and Walmart mandates that all orders need to be sent only on a Friday evening in units of 5, but they should be less than 1 MB in length, right? So these are some of the constraints that your partner can offer, and some of the batching concepts can help you achieve that configuration. And of course, we have tracking and ACK correlation where you would want to troubleshoot whether you have received a message, and for that message, is there an ACK correlation, and do you want to do archiving with that message. What we do is, as part of the cloud, in addition to the benefits Srivatsan and Samir have mentioned, we also have a rich trading partner management portal, and this is the portal that your operator will use to configure and manage the trading partner relationships. So all the set of concepts that we expose, the partners, the profiles, and the agreements would be managed through this portal. And the other important addition that we've made to services is making the trading partner management OM API public. So, which means that you're not restricted to the set of portal UI configuration experience we offer. You can build your own rich UI, and in fact, there are scenarios where you can integrate it with SharePoint, and SharePoint could be part of a larger business application in your organization. The other key features we have is around archiving. Archiving is fairly common in retail scenarios where you send a purchase order and you want it to be part of a NRR scenario where you would want to be able to say to your customer that, hey, I sent a purchase order for $1,000. And tomorrow you can vouch that claim saying, yes, I received an MDN for that purchase order, therefore it is still a valid message. So you can couple that with an AS2 agreement, which is a transport protocol, and ensure that you can have a legal claim as to be able to send a message or having received a message, right? So what BizTalk services on Azure does essentially combines all these benefits, and you have a rich trading partner management experience for B2B in BizTalk services today. Now, let's quickly summarize these concepts in the form of a demo, and I'll walk you through an experience where we quickly create an agreement in a matter of minutes. So this is the new trading partner management experience. So let me start off by keying in the URL. The way you land in this page is through the manage icon in BizTalk services seen through the Azure portal. So if you go to manage.windowsazure.com, you can see that for the deployment, there is a manage button that's enabled for BizTalk services. And you would have to choose the manage button, and then that would launch the portal. Notice that for folks who have used preview, this is slightly different from the initial view that you would see, right? One of the things we did was to take your feedback on saying that, hey, can we have a single account manage multiple deployments, right? Earlier, it used to be that one live ID could, Microsoft account can manage one deployment. Now that restriction has gone away, and you can have multiple deployments in this account. So I have one configured here. Let me log into that. So it fetches the list of partners and agreements, and you have the ability to be able to create a new partner at the click of a button. Let's say this is Microsoft. And that's it. You have the Microsoft partner ready. And by default, every Microsoft partner also creates a profile. And the profile, you can add the qualifiers, the identities, the certificates associated with that profile, the templates that you would want to do. Templates is a logical abstraction of the settings that you would want to reuse as part of profiles. Once you have created a profile, let me add another one for the creation of the agreement. Let's say this is a laptop company X, right? So this is where we want to certify all the Windows that we ship runs on a particular laptop configuration, so we have a trading partner relationships, right? All I have to do is, after I have created the partners, I need to go to the agreements page, and you're presented with a view to create a different type of an agreement. In the current view, we have support for X12, and X12 is more of American-specific protocol for retail and logistics transactions, so you can create X12 agreements. Along with that, you can create AS2 agreements. AS2 is the transport protocol that gives you compression, you can sign a message, you can encrypt a message, so there's a bunch of algorithms that come as part of AS2, right? So let's look at X12, right? Let me click on add, and all I have to do is give a name for this agreement. So let me call it, I can give some description. Let's say this is for Win 8.1 validation. I can choose my partner. In this case, it is Microsoft, which is a hosted partner, which essentially means that the solution is deployed for Microsoft. And then there is a guest partner. In this case, I'm talking to the company X, so therefore I put that on the guest partner. I also need to add in identifiers. So these are some fields or numbers, if you will, that are added as part of the message that are very unique to your company. You might have registered with DUNS, it might be your phone number, SSN, something that is unique to your company and that can identify the particular message. Here I'm going to choose custom, which is represented by ZZ. And I'm going to say this is MS, this is company X, right? Notice I have an option to turn on archiving and tracking at the click of a button. So I would want archiving immediately after I receive a message, so I know I have the pristine format, or I need to archive a message just before I send it to my trading partner, so I can achieve the message that I actually sent to my partner. Right, once I have that locked down, I can click on continue. And what follows is two settings, right? One is on the receive side. So what are all the settings that I need to configure when I receive a message? And the flip is, what are the settings I need to configure when I send a message, right? So now let's look at what I need to configure when Microsoft receives a message. So the first thing I would do is transport. The most common transports in the EDI world are, you know, FTP, SFTP, and AS2. But we do tend to expose HTTP as well, typically for test scenarios where you want to ensure that your settings has been configured correctly. Right, so I'll leave it at HTTP for now, and I can also promote properties that I feel are important coming from my HTTP transport. Right, and next I choose the protocol. So protocol mandates, like, how do I understand the format of a message? This is not plain XML to XSD validation, right? You have purchase order schema, and purchase order schema implies that there's something called value, there's a sender receiver, there's a quantity, there are line items, there's a description of the line items, there are different fields that are mandated by the standard, and can I have validation at that level? Can I have properties promoted from those fields? So some of those configuration happens at the protocol stage. You can also choose to accept or mandate receiving of acknowledgments. 997 is just a flavor of the acknowledgement specific to the X12 standard. And TA1 is just the technical acknowledgement. Again, another superset of acknowledgement at the interchange level. So I'm going to add a schema. So in this case, let's say I want to validate an 850. So let's say I'm receiving a purchase order, and once I receive the purchase order, I need to be able to respond back with an invoice, right? So in the X12 land, 850 translates to a purchase order. I can transform the message. In this case, I choose not to. So transform experience was shown by Samir. So the T TRFM transform file would be handed over from the developer to the business admin, and the business admin would upload the transform in this case, right? Once I transform the message, I can route the message. So I have received a message from my partner, and I can route the message to one of my target destinations. I can do using service bus, I can route it to another bridge, or I can route it to a blob, right? Let me say I need to route it to a bridge, and I'm going to route it to a PDF invoice bridge. So the scenario is I'm receiving the purchase order, and I want to be able to extract fields from the purchase order, namely the item, name, quantity, description, and be able to pre-fill some of those details into my invoice so I don't have to reconstruct it from my LOB. So the next time I get my LOB with the dollar amount, I'm going to plug it in and push back the invoice back to the system. Right? So that's my receive settings. The send settings is the converse, right? So now I have a message in my line of business system. Now I want to be able to send that to my trading partner from Microsoft. Right. So what you do is you have the endpoint defined to which you pump the message to the cloud. That's your inbound URL and your gateway into the EDI agreement. You can transform the message from its current format into the EDI XML format that BizTalk Services understands. You can batch the message. So the batch configuration is the one that I've been talking about. Right. Let's say I define a batch of three. Right. So I can specify my regular expression to say which messages qualify into the batch. In this case, I'm going to allow all messages. You could selectively identify the type of the message, or you could promote a property and say, hey, all messages particular to geography X are part of batch one, right? So you could have complex configurations such as those. Click next, and your batch release criteria essentially says, when do you need to send a message? What's the release criteria, right? So I could choose a combination of schedule and count, which means I need, let's say, a size of three, but that size of three should happen every week, and it can happen, the first release happens today at 12 p.m., and it occurs every week. So I can pretty much configure whether it happens on a Friday, at what time, how long, and what is the size of the message, right? Once I configure this, I can save, and my batch is ready. It's not in the active state, but once I deploy my agreement, I can get my agreement in the start states. Right. So once I configure my batching, I can choose protocol. This is the protocol that my partner understands. Now, earlier you saw that I have received a purchase order. Now I have to configure sending of an invoice. So let me go ahead and add the schema. And I choose 810, which is, again, a format specific to the XML standard. And I want to be able to receive acknowledgments for the messages I sent. Finally, I go to transport, and here I can choose my bridge configuration. So typically, you would configure your trading partner settings, but if you want to have an intermediary stage, you can configure your bridge or your blob settings, like you configure the SFTP and AS2. Similarly, we have the concept of suspend endpoint. If there are failures that occur when you're trying to send a message or when you're trying to receive a message, you cannot go back to your trading partner, pick up the phone and say, hey, you know what, there's something wrong with BizTalk Services, you need to resend the message. We don't have scenarios where you would call up trading partners and be able to be on the phone, right? So we have a mechanism where if the message is wrong, syntactically, structurally, or there's a field within the message that's wrong due to bad LOB configuration, we have that message pushed into an endpoint that you define. Like in this case, you can say Azure Blob is probably a good candidate. It's very reliable. So whenever there is a message suspension, push that message into Azure Blob. I'll have a different process configured to pick up messages from Azure Blob and have my retry, resubmit workflow running on Azure Blob. So that's the kind of configuration you would do here. And with Azure Blob, you would have to give a shared access signature URL, which means you would have to configure your policy names, read-write access, the duration, all of that, create the whole SAS URL, and have that pasted into this field, right? So now what I'm going to do is I'm actually going to open up a pre-created agreement just to speed things up. And we will send a sample message. So this is something that I created just before this presentation. What this agreement is trying to do is essentially the same thing. So now I'm going to receive a message. My protocol is set to 850, and I'm routing the message this time to a queue, right? The queue is one of the valid options for route as well. So all I have is two simple queues, right? There's a good queue and there's a bad queue. So the good queue is where I actually deliver successful messages. All my suspended messages end up in the bad queue. And similarly, on the send side, I'm going to configure my 810, and my transport is again going to be the good queue and the bad queue, just to simplify the whole configuration experience, right? The key factor is, if you look at my route settings, I would have to know where the service bus URL is. So I'm going to open my Service Bus Explorer, have it refreshed. I have all my queues handy. Let me make sure I receive all the messages. Okay, there's a bunch of messages. So what I'm trying to do is get the orders message, and I also hooked it up with another pipeline where I can take that message and see if I can convert it into a PDF format, right? Sam earlier talked about how e-invoicing is a popular scenario in Europe. So one of the concepts is when you receive a purchase order, you can always pre-populate it with an invoice, and once you have the filled in fields, send that in a format that the target understands. In this case, I can convert that message not in an EDI format, but I can introduce a custom pipeline component and have that converted from my EDI format into XML, and then from XML into PDF, sign the PDF, send it to the partner and say, hey, you know what, that's the signed PDF that has all the invoice-related details, right? Back to the demo. So I have a console application that's going to send a message to my URL. So here you notice that I'm using the standard message sender application. This is used to send messages to every endpoint that is secured by ACS in BizTalk services today. I have specified my ACS namespace, issuer name, issuer secret, and the URL. In this case, the URL that I have given is of my receive settings. So I have given this URL here. So that's the location that I'm going to pump my message. So I'm receiving a message from my partner. And the message that I'm going to send is, okay, so it's a small flat file instance. Let me show you what it contains. It's a fairly simple file. I just have a contesto fabricam. For those of you familiar with the notation here, let me zoom this up. So I have a header field. It says it's a purchase order. There's a number to that 850. There's a sender receiver identified by fab and con. You know, rest of the details are more interesting if you want to promote or parse the message, right? So we leave it at that. And let's push this message as a text/plain because it's a flat file format. I'm just giving the HTTP content type and press enter. So what happens is that the message is pushed to that endpoint, and what you get is a tracking ID. So this is a unique GUID that you get for every message that's pushed into the system. So you can use this information to track the message flow across the EDI agreement flow, right? And we'll see that in a minute. So if I go back to my portal, now that I've pumped a message, let me go to my tracking view. It's about 12 p.m. Local time here. So all I need to do is look for that message, and there you go. So you notice that it has taken the success route as opposed to the suspend route, right? So I know that, okay, I have successfully received the message, and the message has been routed to the good queue. I can click on details, and this is going to show me the list of all fields that were sent. You know, remember the ISA, FabCon with all the other details or what the order is. So this is the message that I sent across. I can go to my good queue and then do a peek, and it should show me one, and the one message is exactly the one that I received, right? So this is the same message that, but you're seeing this in XML because once I receive a flat file EDI with content text slash plain, it gets parsed by the protocol stage and what gets pushed out is the XML file. In tomorrow's session, we'll go deeper into what this demo is and connect this with another bridge. And we'll have that, we'll have the EDI integrated with EAI and make sure we get the PDF out of the system. So I'll show that in a minute. So this in a gist, is about what an agreement is, how can you configure the agreement and have a trading partner relationship set up between Microsoft and, you know, actually any two partners in your organization. Can we go back? Okay. So we looked at agreement, right? So one of the questions that we often hear from customers, in fact, we heard this yesterday, is, we have a lot of, customers have a lot of investments in BizTalk server, right? And the question naturally is, hey, you know what, BizTalk services is cool, it enables a whole lot of scenarios, you looked at the capabilities, but how do I leverage some of the data that I've already configured? You know, typically, you might have hundreds of partners in your server system, how can I take those data? I don't want to be able to go to the portal, click create partner 100 times, right? That's, you would probably want to leverage some of the data. What we have is a TPM data migration tool. So this TPM data migration tool is actually available as part of the SDK downloads, as we say. It's just gone live, so it's available in the SDK downloads page. You can use the TPM data migration tool, point it to your BizTalk server, key in a bunch of credentials, click next through a wizard, and bam, you have all of those data available in BizTalk service. And that's the demo we're going to see next. If we can go back to my system. So what we have is the TPM data migration tool here. I have launched the tool. So this tool has a look and feel that's very similar to that of the BizTalk portal. So let me click next. So this is a wizard-driven experience. First, I need to identify where my BizTalk server is. Thankfully, that BizTalk server is on my laptop. I'm going to show you the admin console. So I have that BizTalk group running in here. I have trading partners. And for simplicity, I've just created partner one and partner two and created an X12 agreement between those two partners, right? And if you look at the identifiers, it's sender and receiver. Here it's receiver sender, right? Rest of the details are in some sense optional here, but we'll make sure that we grab those settings as well, right? So that's BizTalk server configuration, and it's on my local machine, so I'm just going to enter my laptop configuration. The default is BizTalk Management DB, Windows Auth, and now it asks me for the Azure credentials, like, hey, which is a deployment where you'd want to push these details, right? So I'm going to say push it to apps-test.info. This is my deployment that I've created on Azure. It's a different URL format because I've masked it with a custom domain. So that's the domain that I own, and I have mapped it to my deployment, so you can actually create your own organization URL, and what's behind, whether it's Azure or whether it's server, is totally masked. So in this case, I've created a BizTalk apps-test.info URL. So let me go ahead and enter my ACS details. This should be available once you have created the deployment. So let me just copy paste these numbers and click next, right? So it's going to actually connect to your BizTalk server and list the partners and the number of profiles it has. I would want both. Before we go into the demo, let me make sure that I don't have that created, just for the sake of the demo. I don't have partner one, party two. Let me click next, and I get an error, primarily because the set of DLLs needs to be verified. So let me launch the wizard again so it gets the updated DLLs. Okay. And the deployment URL. So the way you would do this is pick up the details from the ACS portal and have them migrated. Okay, there you go. So what is important is you have to get the deployment URL and the ACS credentials correct. In fact, we have a nice README which says that, hey, if this error happens, what to do next? And essentially, that's what I followed. Right. So once you migrated the partners, it fetches the list of agreements that are associated with the partner. Right. Now, this is the same agreement BT server that you're seeing here in my server product today. And yes, it has discovered that that's the one. And I need to say for whom I'm migrating, right? So think of this as the Microsoft Company X example, right? So it's party one, that's my hosted partner, and I click next. It's going to read all of the settings of that agreement and pump it into the cloud. So now that's done. And it says two of two partners migrated, one agreement successfully migrated. There's a log of all that has happened. Looks like things are good. All the ZZ and the numbers are good. So now I can close this wizard, go back to my portal, do a small refresh, and hopefully my partners and agreements should surface in this UI, right? So just to make sure we get the right detail, I go back to my system, and there you go. You can see partner one and partner two. I go into agreements, and you should see agreement listed in the system with the sender and receiver. There you go. In a matter of clicks, I have actually migrated two partners with agreement. You could think of this as repetitive. I could do it for 100 and just be done in minutes, right? So that's the whole agreement demo. So it kind of helps you leverage your existing investments. We'll go back to the slide and walk through what else is available in BizTalk services, right? So we've been hearing your feedback, right? We went preview in June. We got hundreds of customers going live and trying out the different editions that we have on BizTalk. And one of the key feature asks was, hey, can I start small with B2B and then grow? And we've heard your feedback. And what we have is EDI is available in all SKUs. EDI is available in basic, standard, developer, and premium. So it's available on the SKUs, and you can start small and then grow as you have more partners and agreements. The second feedback that we heard was, hey, can I have multiple users manage this deployment? Typically, you know, it was a real scenario where we had one live ID, and that was shared between two customers and said, hey, is it possible that I can have more than one? And of course, the answer is yes. So now you have multiple users managing the same deployment, and the converse, the same user can manage multiple deployments. So it's completely flexible. You can go to the portal. There's a settings page where you just key in your email ID, and you can use it for all deployments. Right? There's a whole bunch of feedback that has been added, right, from preview to GA. I'll call out a few ones. Interesting one is the business continuity and SLA. Now that we are in GA, we are cognizant of the service levels that we offer. BizTalk services will be at 99.9% SLA, on par with the rest of Azure. We are shipping a tool called for backup and restore, so you can back up your environment in case of DR or your configuration migration, restore it on another environment. We'll look at that in detail in tomorrow's session on what that is. We can migrate TPM data, that's the demo you saw, and some of the setup dependencies with App Fabric 1.0 and the kind of setup dependencies that we have are now removed, and the setup automatically tries to detect the dependencies and installs them for you. It's more a convenience thing that we have added. And that's not it. So we have started our vNext with this. So vNext is obviously as exciting as preview and GA was. So whole bunch of asks, and I'm sure if your favorite feature is missing, please do stop by. Folks are going to be here. Let us know what your feature is, and we'll be more than happy to see if we can bake that into the plan. This is what we are working on now. So, and there is artifact support, adapter frameworks, workflows, scheduled backup, AAD pull from service bus, queue and topic, some of the things Vivek has already talked about. So this is like pretty exciting stuff. Before I proceed, I want to take a quick show of hands. How many of you would need EDIFACT? Okay, I thought this was US. Like, there's a whole bunch of people in from Europe, I guess. So what I'm going to do is actually show an EDIFACT demo. So this is just bits out of the dev box, right? And this is like fairly, so bear with me if things don't go well, but hey, you know what? That's the way we function. We just want to get the bits out as early as possible, right? So let's switch back to the laptop and we'll try an EDIFACT demo. So all I need to do is go back to our familiar screen. And we have the environment created for EDIFACT. So let me go into the deployment. And you guys should be experts by now. It's so simple that you just need two partners. I have created an agreement, but hey, you know what? This is an EDIFACT agreement. So you can see that the protocol is EDIFACT with the set of partners, and it is deployed, right? So I click on EDIFACT. And you see the settings for EDIFACT, right? Like here, I've configured my DUNS number, yet to configure tracking. In my receive settings, the key one is the protocol, right? So let's go into the protocol, and you can see that I have configured my control messages, send side, and I've configured my, you know, EPRAC, invoke, and order messages for, I believe it's D98B, yes. So I've chosen a protocol, chosen a format, and configured the schemas as part of my agreement, right? And then the rest of the configuration is similar, transform and route. I'm just pumping all messages into my blob just for convenience. Send settings, again, I have my transform batching. I have configured an EDI batch now. So my EDI batch is the similar count of three. So I pump three messages, and the message will come out after I have, you know, a transaction sets with an interchange transactions and count of three. Protocol, again, I can choose my UNB values. The UNOA is an optional segment. So here we configure the UNB sender and receiver identifiers. And here I have also used the EPRAC and the order XSD message, and I transport it back to my blob, right? So what I'm going to do is just go to my storage explorer, and these are my blob endpoints, right? So I can receive a message and I can send a message, right? So let me clear out all existing files. Okay, that's fine. Now, I have a success endpoint, which is my container, and I also have my receive and send success containers, right? So let me go to my console again, but this time I'm going to send and receive EDIFACT messages. So let me show you what the EDIFACT message is. It's the orders message, right? So folks familiar with the protocol, this is slightly different from the X12, but hey, you know what? So this is the orders message. I have my sender receiver identifiers and the rest of the stuff that's part of the protocol, right? Of course, I have a UNA, although it's optional, right? So what I'm going to do is first do the demo with receiving a message, right? I'm going to push this invoice EDI file into my endpoint and be able to process that in XML, right? So I send the message to the EDI endpoint. This is an EDIFACT message, and notice that the message has been processed successfully. I go to EDI receive success, and I see three files. Any idea why I'm seeing three files? Okay, so one is for the actual message, the other one is for the control message, which is at the technical ACK, and the other one is the functional ACK, right? I see three ACKs just to see that it is actually the message. So if I go to the message, you can see that this is like control ACK. If I look at, this is the my TA, and this should be my message, right? So notice that I sent my EDI D98 invoke message, and now that's been parsed from the flat file message into my XML. Let's try and do the converse, right, just to make sure we've completed the send and receive sides. But remember that this time I have a batch configured. It's a batch of three. So probably need to send three messages before it actually turns up at the blob side, right? So let me just clear this out. And all I'm pasting is, again, it's the message sender that we've already shipped. There's an endpoint, access ACS details, and I'm passing a D98 orders output XML. So all I'm expecting is I'm doing an XML into flat file. Message sent successfully. I go back here and say send. It wouldn't show up because the batch count is 3, so that's one message. So I'm going to run that again. And that should be sent successfully as well. Here you go. And I do it third time. So at that time, the batch criteria is evaluated to true, and the message would get pushed out into the blob store. It's happened, so I come back here and click on send success, and there you see, if I go to the text, you can see that you get your flat file message. So the purpose of this demo was to actually say that, yes, we are working on EDIFACT, and it's in progress. So hopefully, if all of you who raised your hands, let us know. We will soon have something equivalent of a tap. We would more than happy to have you guys on board, try out the bits and give us feedback, and hopefully the product, the feature should roll out very, very soon. All right, back to the deck. So that was EDIFACT, and pretty much we have covered you know, the set of slides that we would want to discuss. The kind of summary that I do want to give is BizTalk Services has been in a mode where we would want to be agile, and that's something Vivek talked about. We would want to be agile and have a cadence on a quarterly basis. So that's where we would want to have a stronger community interaction, be able to have feedback. So do go ahead and try out the GA bits. Send us your feedback if something doesn't fit in your scenario or you want to discuss more on how some capability can be used. Do let us know. We'll be more than happy to discuss with you guys. And with that, I'd like to conclude my presentation.